and I think we move now to the next speaker before the break. That will be, it's a pleasure, will be to have here Dr. Miguel Navarro-Cía, that will tell us about electromagnetic metamaterials technology. So a really general and nice title. Please, Miguel, when you are ready.
So thank you, Vincenzo. Thank you, the organizers in general, for putting together this nice program, a scientific program, especially for inviting me to contribute to the program of this symposium. So my name, well, good afternoon, good morning, afternoon, evening, wherever you are. My name is Miguel Navarro-Cía. I work at University of Birmingham. And yeah, today I want to talk about electromagnetic metamaterials technology. So basically, I want to show you how can we use metamaterials, okay? So what benefits metamaterials can bring us, or can what advantages can we can gain with metamaterials. So this is basically one of the strands of the research done here at University of Birmingham in my group, but it does have connections with other strands. And specifically, if I have enough time, I will show you the connection with the imaging, terahertz imaging strand here at University of Birmingham. So in this presentation, I'm gonna discuss, I'm gonna cover basically, I would say two sections. One section, the first one, will be about metamaterials, or well, metamaterials inspired devices, okay? And then the second section will be about metasurfaces. So basically the 2D analog of metamaterials, and I will discuss basically devices based on metasurfaces. So this is basically the outline. So as far as metamaterials inspired components is concerned, right, let me see this, yep. I want to discuss, the topic that I want to discuss is tunability and reconfigurability, okay? So how can we use metamaterials concepts, maybe, okay, for reconfigurability or tunability devices, mainly at microwave frequencies. And just to motivate a bit this work, just let's think for a moment about waveguides, okay? So transmission lines at microwaves, and how can, and the different schemes that we have to have some type of tunability. So if we want to basically have attenuation of the waveguide, or the mode provided in the waveguide, we basically have two options. One is manual option, okay? So basically just screwing in a metal piece into the waveguide just to short circuit it, okay? And the other one, a bit more advanced, is based on MEMS, okay? So that's basically the two options that we have. The MEMS approach is rather complex in terms from the technology point of view and fabrication point of view is kind of complex. So ideally you want to avoid that option, okay? But can we actually do something else? I mean, instead of using manual tuning or MEMS reconfigurability. So that was kind of our question at the time, a few years ago. And we got a bit of inspired by the work on spin orbit interaction coupling done at optical frequencies. So at optics, they have shown that exploiting actually polarization, circularly polarized light, okay, we can do very fancy stuff. So for instance, you can rotate a metallic nanoparticle as shown basically, let's see if I put the laser pointer now, as shown here, okay? So and depending on the handedness of the polarization, the particle rotates one way or the another, okay? There is also this transverse shift known as the invert Fedorov shift, okay, where depending on the polarization, the handedness of the circularly polarized light impinging into the interface of this isotropic material, the reflection will undergo kind of a shift, okay? Here, obviously, is enlarged, so it's a tiny shift. We are talking about nanometers, but there is a shift towards left or towards the right, depending on the polarization, on the handedness of the incident polarization light. Another nice application was actually, and it seems that the video is not working, but this one at the bottom left, where basically by having a spinning dipole close to a metallic surface, you could excite the surface plasmon, but only in one direction. Okay, so the excitation is unidirectional of the surface plasmon. Okay, and one closer maybe to something more interesting from the microwave point of view or for antennas is this work here at the bottom right, where basically, depending on the handedness of the incident polarized light, the energy, the light was coupling to one of the waveguides or to another. Okay. And that has a quite significant implications from the antenna point of view, from microwave engineering antenna. Okay. So inspired by this work, all these works, we decided to look, so the work of spin orbit coupling, we decided to look at this type of waveguide. So a helical type waveguide. You see, it's metallic, and you have this, you have chirality, basically, okay? We look at this waveguide, we look at the first, at the reflection, when the impinging signal was circularly polarized, right or left-handed, okay? And here I am plotting the reflection. So S11 is basically reflection. And regardless of the handedness, reflection was very low, okay? Very, very low, meaning that the energy was coupling into this waveguide, okay? Something was happening, something was happening with the transmission. So if I plot transmission for the right-handed circularly polarized light, transmission was very nice, okay? So that means that actually my energy is not only coupling in, but also is propagating along the waveguide until the end, okay? For that polarization. But when we were looking at the other polarization, at the left-handed, there was a significant decrease in transmission. And attenuation in the waveguide absorption, ohmic losses, was not actually a reason for that, because the even simulation with perfect electric conductor were showing this. So what was going on? Well, the thing that happens is that for the left-handed polarized light, that particular waveguide was actually working as an antenna, okay? Actually, it was working as an antenna producing a vortex beam, okay? But I'm not gonna discuss anything about vortex beam. So basically, we have a platform that depending on the handedness of your polarization, the device works either as a waveguide or as an antenna, okay? So we are somehow using polarization to reconfigure your device. We did study this waveguide in terms of dispersion diagram, just to show that basically for the left-handed, what we have is a dispersion within the line cone, which explains why this structure works as an antenna, okay? Whereas for the right-handed circularly polarized light, the band was beyond basically the line cone, light line, and therefore it's a confined mode. Actually, that you can plot the electric field, and you see that for the left-handed circularly polarized light, the mode actually is leaking, okay? So it's an antenna, it's a leaky mode actually. And for the right-handed, actually the mode here is confined at the surface. In a way, if you want to use some analogy, it's like a surface wave, or like a surface plasmon, okay? In a way. As an analogy, okay? I'm not saying that it's exactly the same. So, okay, so depending on the polarization, we have a device that is either a waveguide or an antenna, okay? But what about if you want to have the same device to always work as an antenna, but what we want to do is to change the properties of that antenna, the radiation properties of the antenna, to tune the radiation properties of the antenna depending on the polarization. So what we can do is just a tiny trick. So what we can put, we can do is we can put a mirror at the end of the waveguide such that the polarization of light that travels through the waveguide upon reflection actually has the same handedness as the waveguide, such that for one polarization, the radiation will be in this direction, okay, in this upward, but in that angle, whereas for the other polarization, the mode will travel all the way through the waveguide, and when upon reflection, it will start leaking and pointing in the opposite direction, basically. Okay? Upwards, but in the opposite direction. And on top of that, we can taper the tape. We can taper the slot such to not modify, but just to improve the radiation characteristic of this waveguide. So we apply a common approach, an adiabatic Taylor distribution, such as to reduce side load levels. Okay, in principle, an antenna, from an antenna perspective, you want to have a main lobe, highly directive antenna with a main lobe, and you want to minimize side load levels in most practical applications. Okay, so as I said, this works, well, as explained, for one polarization, left-handed, the wave is propagating and at the same time is leaking, so with that radiation. For the other polarization, what happens is that the wave propagates along the waveguide, and upon reflection, then is when it starts leaking, and it leaks in the opposite direction, okay? Opposite angle. So this this type of device, so obviously it was measured in an anechoic chamber, and here you have the radiation pattern as a function of frequency, and okay, for that the different colors, and as a function of polarization. And basically, we prove that for one polarization, my waveguide is propagating in, let's say it's around 100 degrees, okay? When I change the polarization, actually is at the other angle, so let's say this is around 70 to 80 degrees, okay? And obviously, since it's a leaky wave antenna, it has is frequency dispersive, okay? So it has dispersion. So depending on the frequency, you also have you direct basically the angle of radiation of the main lobe, okay? And basically, at the bottom, you can see basically the characteristic of this antenna in numbers. So that's basically one of the devices inspiring spin orbit coupling. In a way, it's a concept going around plasmonics and metamaterials to basically have reconfigurability at microwaves. Right, move, yeah. On top of this, we are also trying to look at how to have other type of tunability. We are looking at this material, vanadium dioxide, VO2, okay, which is known to have a phase change at few degrees, okay, at around 60 degrees, so relatively close room temperature, okay. So it goes from metal to dielectric, okay, and to exploit this for tunability as well. Okay, and this is basically, I should say that this is mainly a material science research and is mainly led by Lomonosov Moscow State University. So this is basically a collaboration where we basically try to use these samples for terahertz. So as I said, this is mainly material science, and there is a lot to discuss about how to fabricate these samples and thickness, because making this thick is always a bit tricky, but I'm not an expert on that. So I'm gonna just show you that under a very good procedure developed by my colleagues in Moscow, they can actually realize a very good VO2 films, okay, with relatively good thickness, okay, with an amazing hysteresis performance here, okay, a very sharp performance. Okay, and we basically tested this at terahertz, whether this type of material could be used at terahertz. Okay, and basically here you see how by changing temperature, so around 58 degrees, there is a change between transmission, almost in this case 72% transmission, to almost 10% transmission. Keeping in mind that this thickness is, we're talking about 200 nanometers. So something that is deep sub-wavelength basically can be tuned to be either almost transparent to almost opaque. And it's just exploiting the fact that this VO2 goes from metallic-like behavior to dielectric-type behavior by just changing the temperature slightly. Okay. Obviously, this is not going to be as fast as tunability with electronics, but we are talking about milliseconds transition. Okay, so it starts to be something that could be considered for some applications. Okay, and here at the bottom is basically the representation of frequency and this temperature, and just to see the sharp transition. Okay, so and that's all from the metamaterial point of view, let's say. And let's move on to metasurfaces-based components, okay? And I will be discussing about antennas mainly and about detectors. And the first thing is just a bit of motivation. And actually one of the previous speakers just also discussed about metasurfaces. And it's basically motivation for me was that the world is moving from 3D to 2D. And I have here some examples. 20 years ago, we had TVs as bulky as the one at the bottom, or mobile phones that they were not actually mobile phones, they were more portable phones, okay? They were kind of heavy. Nowadays, everything is 2D, and we're moving towards 2D, and everything needs to be compact. So somehow we need to be able to replicate the same functionalities that we have with metamaterials, in a 2D platform, so with metasurfaces, okay? So that's kind of motivation. So the first thing that I want to discuss is something about basically metasurfaces for antennas, okay? And I'm gonna start with something that is a bit more theoretical, okay? Just to help you understand the following results. And actually this explanation also helps understanding the previous results on the helical waveguide. Okay. So imagine that I have a metallic mirror, a metallic slab, and I have a small aperture there, and then I make some corrugations. Okay. So this particular platform actually acts like a liquid wave antenna. So energy going through this slot will radiate as a space wave, and some energy will couple to a wave that travels along the surface and leaks energy, okay? And under certain conditions, you can couple this space wave, so the direction of the space wave and the liquid wave is almost broadside, and you have a very nice pencil-like radiation, okay? So from the dispersion diagram point of view, it's very simple to explain. So imagine that you have just a simple metallic slab, a smooth one, okay? And you try to compute the dispersion diagram of this. So obviously, the mode is a plane, a grazing angle plane wave represented by these two minus 45 and 45 degree angles kind of curves, okay? When you introduce some corrugations, we all know that there is this folding of the into the previewing zone, okay? And we excite what are known, at least in the microwave community, as space harmonics, okay? So you have all these additional lines in the dispersion diagram. And obviously, there is some crossing, some anti-crossing between all these lines. And eventually, your dispersion diagram looks something like that, where you have all these space harmonics, okay? And with this type of available modes, okay? If I'm exciting this corrugated platform from one end, the only branches of these space harmonics that make sense are the ones with a positive group velocity. So the energy is moving away from the surface. So the only possible basically branches are these ones, okay? The ones with the positive slope, okay? And now we know that any branch that is within the light cone can radiate, okay? And I can tell you that in this particular picture, if I have a mode and I change frequency, because this is basically frequency, this mode will radiate here as backward. It will, as a function of frequency, it moves towards broadside, that is at this point. And if you continue with this branch, then you move towards this side, okay? So as a function of frequency, you basically go from backward radiation to broadside to forward radiation. Very much as the waveguide, the tape waveguide, helical tape waveguide described earlier. So we have this. So we now understand a bit how to interpret this type of leaky wave. So let's simulate the example and let's see what we can observe. So when there is no corrugations, as I say, we have this space wave. So we have an isotropic radiation. From an antenna point of view, not very exciting, not that good, okay? However, when we put the corrugations and under at the right frequency, so basically at this frequency, we have broadband radiation of the liquid mode, and we have this enhanced of radiation broadside, okay? So we have a relatively nice pencil-like radiation. Notice that the wave, the surface wave, that is a leaky wave propagating here, is propagating with kind of, it's a left-handed mode, okay? It's a backward wave mode. So the even though the energy is going this way, the phase is evolving in the opposite direction. And that makes sense because this is this branch is basically is the same as a negative index of refraction, if you want, if you wish, material, equivalent material. Okay, so we have this. And this is a very nice platform because we have a flat antenna, very flat antenna, and actually with a relatively good directivity. If our interpretation of this antenna is, as I explained to you, there is energy coupling to a surface mode and leaks as it hits the corrugation, well, we can actually tune the properties of the radiation in time by just modifying the corrugation. So in this case, I have the antenna, a bull-sized antenna is known, and the corrugations are basically constant, okay? So what we observe is that, well, first of all, we have four oscillations in my pulse, and it's because I have the one oscillation is coming direct through the space wave. The second oscillation is actually the energy that goes to the first groove and is radiated. That comes a bit later. The next oscillation is from the second groove, and so on and so forth. Okay. But if each of these oscillations are identified with one of these grooves, by tailoring this groove, I can actually tailor the waveform, okay? So I can shape the pulse. And that's what we did here, which we just, by changing just varying as simple as the groove depth, we could actually shape the output pulse, okay? So we have a very simple pulse shaping platform, right? But as I said, the really beauty of this leaky wave antenna is the fact that it's planar, okay? And that has significant important consequences for some applications like the CubeSat. And I'm gonna share, because maybe not you don't all know what is a CubeSat. So the CubeSat is this scientific satellite, very popular now in amateur community and also in scientific community. You see the size. So it's basically not nano in nano scale, but very nano compared to the size of the normal satellites. So it's a shoebox kind of size satellite, okay, that is now very much in use for scientific exploration in space. Okay, and as you see, the fact that it's so small, this satellite means that there is not much space to put antennas, and it will be great if the antenna can be actually placed. Okay, so I have lots to do. Okay, so sorry. Yeah, so in this antenna, obviously you want something that is planar, flat, okay? So we can exploit these leaky wave antennas. So with that in mind, we 3D print this antenna, this flat one. Obviously there are some issues here, okay? Some fabrication issues, but we tested it, okay? For different frequencies, the realized guys gain was around 20 dBs, a nice gain. And basically we can observe how, as a function of frequency, these space harmonics, okay, space harmonics just move in frequency. And there's a frequency which corresponds to this frequency where they cross over, okay? And we have this radiation at the angle that we want. In this case, it was not broadside. It was designed to have radiation at a certain angle, around 15 to 20 dBs. 20 degrees, sorry. Right, so that's the antenna. Something just to go very quickly. We can also use metasurfaces to manipulate beams. In this case, we design a metasurface. Locally, we change the complex reflection, okay? Such as to convert, in this case, a Gaussian beam into, well, to focus a Gaussian beam into four different spots, okay? For that, basically, we found the particle, the needed particle to provide the as much reflectivity as possible, ideally one reflectivity, but a reflection that covers a range of phase that covers 360 degrees. We realized that particular metasurface reflect array, okay? And well, that's the simulation and that's the experimental result. And these metasurfaces achieve an efficiency of around above 80%, which it was a world record at the time, operating at terahertz frequencies, okay? So that's it. And the final one is again about how to use metasurfaces, and in this case is to improve detection for terahertz. So if you look at cameras at terahertz, they cost tens of thousands of pounds, even though the pixel size is rather small, okay? So all these cameras cost more than 10K, okay? So cameras at terahertz are very small. Very, very expensive. So can we do something? So the idea that we have is just basically exploit what is known as a single pixel camera. So with a single pixel, we can actually create an image by basically reconstruct the object from a set of intensity values corresponding to different illuminations, okay? But for that, we need still to have a very good detector operating, in this case, at 140 gigahertz. So what we did, and cheap, ideally cheap. So what we did is we took a commercially available infrared detector and made it to work at terahertz frequencies, 140 gigahertz. The way we did it is basically we integrate with the commercial detector a metasurface, a resonant metasurface that forces the radiation to be absorbed in the pyroelectric field and by pyroelectricity basically converted to electric current and therefore to detection. So we designed the absorber, basically the resonant absorber, and basically the without no penalty in the noise equivalent power of the detector, we realized a detector working for terahertz frequency while still working at infrared frequencies, okay, and with a time response that it was actually quite good, around a couple of milliseconds, okay, even though the original detector was working even slower. So actually the modification, the metasurface, what did not only enable terahertz detection, but also speed up the detection. And that brings me to the conclusion, just to be on time and for Vincenzo not to chase me more. So I saw you that
you're perfectly in time.
By combining concepts that are out there in metamaterials, plasmonics, in optics, we can actually realize some reconfigurability, tunability, that might be useful for microwave or terahertz frequencies. And I just show you some examples of how can we use metasurfaces to enable kind of new devices for microwave and terahertz applications. And thanks a lot.
Thank you to you. Very, very nice talk. And we have already a question that is, thank you for the very interesting presentation. How is the efficiency of helical antennas? I also have another question on that.
So that efficiency is difficult to tell, but if I look at efficiency in terms of S11, okay, in terms of how much is reflected, the S11 in dBs was of the order, I think, of minus 15 dBs, okay? And that from an antenna point of view is good enough. Usually the limit is minus 10 dBs. So 10 dBs is basically, just to give you an idea, 10 dBs means that 10% of the power is reflected. So minus 15 dBs means that 95% of the energy is transmitted, and that's whatever it does. In terms of absorption, obviously there is an absorption, but at these frequencies, that design was done at around, if I'm not mistaken, it was around 10 gigahertz. Metal is still rather good. It's perfectly conductor. So basically losses, we did estimate them, and I think we were talking about less than 1 dB in terms of absorption, okay? So very low.
Yeah, makes sense. In the same direction, I have a question if there isn't anyone else. So you did a really nice analog with the induced and electromagnetic transparency, let's say. So if the process is similar, I guess that your antennas will depend, you could tune or will depend also on the thickness and on the width of your, the open space. Is that right?
Yeah, so the width of the slot, let's call it a slot.
It
plays a significant role. And that's why in our second design, we actually tailor that slot to achieve a specific radiation and minimize a side load level. So indeed, the slot, basically, the wider the slot, the more radiation you will have at that particular point in the waveguide. So there is a bit of optimization as well on the length of your total waveguide, because once you have all the energy radiated out from the waveguide, you don't need more waveguide. Okay, yeah. So you just, from the engineering point of view, you just cut there just to reduce cost.
Good. If there aren't any more questions.
There's a question, by Dr. Shoki.
Okay, I don't see it, so you can
in the
ask.
messages.
Yeah, I see. Did you estimate the maximum power that could be handled by such antenna? No, we didn't do a power handling analysis. We did not. I don't expect this to be too terrible in terms of power handling. Okay. And did you think about putting a such antenna in pressure gauge? No, I did not. Obviously, no.
Yeah. Okay. I think there aren't any more questions. So let's thank you again.